Sokoto Caliphate is the creation of Sheikh Usman Damfodio and his disciples, dating back to the 19th century. The present Sultan, His Eminence Had Abu Bakr III, is the 20th Sultan and a direct descendant of Damfodio. What is the history behind the founder of the Sokoto Caliphate? In other words, who was Sheikh Usman Damfodio?
Sheikh Usman Damfodio was one of the leading figures among those in the middle also of the 19th century who were born to a very, very important, very well-known family of the Torankawa. Their great-great-grandfather migrated to somewhere around Kwanni, around the 15th century. They had been known to be scholars. Actually, the word Fodio means a scholar. So Ibn Fodio, or the son of Fodio, means the son of a scholar, because his father Usman was a scholar.
Sheikh Usman Damfodio was the 19th century reformer and revivalist, especially in the Sokoto Caliphate. He was a spiritually motivated person, a well-educated person, an activist in Islam, a reformer who saw the need to reform his society. And he made a big effort to see that he has done that through education, through political awareness, through other things. So he was a model. He's a reformer, a revivalist, a model, and somebody that we should emulate.
So I believe it's a gifted, God-gifted person. God-gifted person who God allows to understand what Quran is and the Hadith, and allowed him also to put it into practice.
He started preaching in the Gobi Kingdom of that time. So from there, he went to Kebbi. He preached there for 5 years. And he went to Zamfara Kingdom. He preached there 1 year. So he started teaching people in order to avoid, that is, innovations.
Virtually every character of magnitude is reenacting one or more myths. It is therefore not surprising that long before Damfodio was born, predictions about his coming were given.
Sheikh Damfodio himself had confirmed the predictions made about his coming in a fulfilled poem composed by him, in which he compared events which occurred to the Prophet and those which occurred to him. He said, Muhammad Sayyidina Rama Hido Warai Niyati Allah Membaya Sayyidina Rama. Muhammad's coming was foretold. I thank Allah, my coming was also foretold. In another hemistich, comparing the predictions on the coming of the Mahdi and that on Shehu himself, he said, Sayyidina Rama Kankobaya Sigarki Miyati Allah Membaya Sayyidina Rama. Meaning, Mahdi's coming was foretold, so also my coming.
The Fulani tribe of Nigeria were wholly nomadic when they entered Hausaland in about the 13th century. However, they are in a continual drift rather than in any great influx at any one time.
Wannan wurin muhimmancin shi shine ake ce ma Maratta. Nan ne aka haifi Sheikh Mujaddid Usman ibn Fodio.
This is Maratta in Niger Republic, where Sheikh Usman Damfodio was born. These are graves of his ancestors, who were originally from Fouta Toro in Senegal, and this was their settlement before they moved to Degel in Nigeria. Indeed, Damfodio was born on a Sunday in December of 1754 in Maratta. Musa Jakolo's descendants moved from Maratta to Degel in Nigeria, among whom were the parents of young Damfodio. Degel is now in Chimola district of Godabawa local government area of Sokoto state. And here is the tomb of Damfodio's father, Shehu Muhammad Salihu, and that of his first son, Sa'ad. But the tomb of Damfodio's mother, Hawa Muhammad Usman, is here at Marnona, some few kilometers away from Degel. In the process of Damfodio's growing up at Degel, he drank deeply from the great pond of knowledge within the Timbuktu tradition of learning and scholarship, which preserved the best of Islam and kept alive its intellectual legacy, strong enough for any determined social reformer to apply as an instrument of societal transformation. Although he was first taught by his parents, he grew up to be known for seeking knowledge wherever it was. Knowledge is what subtly shapes history in man's moral attitude, changes in his inner state of being, changes in his belief, and thus his perception in life, his basic attitudes, his behavior, and therefore, in the ultimate sense, his destiny of following his inherent sense of right or wrong.
These were people who believed that they have a mission in this world. And that mission is not to make money. Because they made no money, they left no money. That mission is not to be powerful so that you can do what you want. Break the rule. Theirs was to transmit what they believe was right based on the teaching of the religion of their choice. That was the religion of Islam.
Damfodio's character was molded in the course of his educational exploits under his teachers of Fulani, Tuaregs, and Hausa tribes. Not a single of them was Arab. In Almagili, Damfodio took from him the concept of tajdid, of societal and of government, and the nature of the ideological divide between Muslims and those who serve the cause of evil. In Al-Barnawi, he understood that law grows and develops through application. He saw the concept of an active, purifying, and transformative jurisprudence that could serve as a potent force for protest and revolutionary mobilization. In Sid Ahmed Baba, Damfodio perceived the role and the place of the scholar in a society from being a reservoir of knowledge to being the guardian of society's conscience, to defending the poor and safeguarding their aspirations, to standing up in the cause of the nation faithful to Allah and submissive to his laws, and help in raising a generation worthy of cause. Perhaps the greatest influence on Damfodio came from Alhaj Jibril B. Umar. It was he that gave him instrument with which to strive against the currents of time. Although the people of Hausaland were Muslims, secret cults like Bori and visits to Boka, the witch doctor, were practiced for fetish purposes, which was at variance with Islam.
Salamu alaikum Boka. Salamu alaikum Boka.
Kai kai kai. Ba'nan. Ba'mun sallama nan. Ni akano kai.
Abinda atta da ni Boka. Mijina lokacin da na aure shi ban gane mu kai ne ba. yanzu abin da ya kawo ninka ina son ka bani taimako sabili da in mallake shi komini ce mini
to wanga ki tayi da shi ki aje ki zuba ruwa cikin su kwana ki zube mai inda ci abinci ya shanye
to
wanga ko ke gane ki kone in kika kone sai ki nike ki kwalli da shi ki kalle shi da shi gajiya
na jiya
don haka aje sallama nan
to
sannan inda ki da ki ta taba bai
to
in za ki ta ki kama hudin babbas tashi tari
to bas
ita da ba yawwa
bas
ki kama hudin babbas har gida yawwa
babbas
aha
babbas
ai
babbas
People of the land indulge in paganism and improper practices with blatant impunity to Allah's injunction. Grievances were leveled against the Hausa rulers on their religious, political, and economic conduct. They were known to be corrupt, immoral, and repressive. Women were treated like animals, while the weak were unduly oppressed. The insecurity, instability, and injustice prevalent became the glaring indices of decline confronting Hausa land. Damfodio was therefore motivated to commence preaching at age 20, which is his life's profession. He was on tours to Kebbi, towns in Gobir Kingdom, Ilo in the middle of Nigeria by its west bank, and Zoma on the way to Zamfara. Damfodio's style of conversion and reform neither preached violence nor bloodshed. No wonder he was able to negotiate an agreement with the powerful Sultan Bao of Gobir, whose tomb is this at Al-Kalawa.
Remember sometimes in 1803, 1802, before the commencement of the Jihad, Shosho Damfodio was invited among other scholars with the invitation of Bao Jangorzo to come and have dinner with him, a Salah dinner in a place called Magami. All the scholars all over this land converged. They met with the highest ranking, you know, a leader of the period. And after the discussion, after the dinner, each of the scholars was given present, royal presents, caskets of gold. But Shosawan Fodio, when it came to his turn, he said, no, I'll not collect your money, but only demand some request from you. What was those requests? Was he like our scholars of today and religious leaders looking for a seat to go for Hajj easily and subsidize, build house for me, or provide this for my mosque, provide this for my house? No. Shehu requested certain things. First, he was requesting that all political prisoners all over this land should be free. Should be free. You free all political prisoners. You reduce taxes against the people. They are overburdened. You reduce taxes against them. You allow free acceptance. Whoever is willing to accept Islam, allow him to do so without hindrance. And you allow people exercise their rights. And also protect people's chastity. Allow women to cover up themselves, because women at the time were hard hit. They were extremely exploited. Like you can see the spill of that in the female slavery that existed, the Korkora system, harem system, that was inherited, I think, historically from the Ottoman system of harem. So he requested all those things. Never he requested single thing for himself, his issues.
And that was
that's what all granted.
However, during the reign of King Nafata, the treaty was disregarded. He ordered converts into Islam to revert to their traditional practices. No new converts were allowed into Islam, while persecution and intimidation became rampant against Muslims. This is the Tabkin Kanu, where many Muslims were said to have been buried even alive. Damfodio's disciples became agitated and wanted to fight back, but he dissuaded them. Then came the reign of Sultan Yunfa of Gobir, who even attempted to assassinate Damfodio. tension escalated to an all-time high. A disciple of Damfodio by the name of Abdul Salam forcibly struck off the chains from a group of Yunfa's Muslim slaves. More tension.
Most of the renowned historians in the world refer to the Sokoto Jihad as a jihad movement, a movement which was conceived by the lower class of the people to rise up against the leadership, because the leadership at that time was tyrannical, was despotic, and was not purely Islamic.
The persecuted, having got a hero in Damfodio, felt encouraged and pinned their hope of redemption on him as they trooped to join him at Gudu. This resulted in the build-up of a Jama'at community, and consequently, Damfodio was elected and pronounced Amirul Mu'minin, or the commander of the faithfuls. The Jama'at was unanimous in Mubai'a, or paying allegiance to Damfodio, first from Umar Mu'akkamu, his lifelong friend, Abdullahi his brother, Muhammad Bello his son, and many others.
This is the house of Shehu himself. Then there are four, and this is the room of Shehu, I mean.
These are the huts of his four wives, Aishatu, Maimunatu, Hawa'u, and Shaturu. This is his school, and here is his mosque. Meanwhile, King Yunfa of Gobir has discreetly sent orders to the Hausa chiefs to put to the sword on the head of every Fulani in their domains. This led more Fulani to flee to join the Jama'at Damfodio at Gudu, who was hitherto not been universally recognized by them as their leader. As Damfodio's supporters increased rapidly, Yunfa became even more afraid of being ousted from office. Yunfa therefore concluded that nothing short of Damfodio's days could save his position, so he declared war against him, which led to the famous Battle of Tapkinkwato.
During the Battle of Tapkinkwato, Shehu Usman, facing the enemy, he rose and prayed that if the aim of his struggle and fighting was to establish a government for himself and his children, may they be defeated utterly.
This is the exact prayer spot just some few meters away from the battleground.
Mu kam lokacin da mun kata muna yan yar muna tawana nan ga sannan itace na kawai durin ga sai an kuda itace sannan ai so nan sannan mun iske itace wadanga giggice da wadanga wadanga don su kasa ta ci sun lalace sun fadi kasa shine wadanga da saura lokacin premier yato anka gine wurin ga an gine masallacin anka yi dabin ga wadanga kurara na inda suka kai sai anka basu nan anka bi anka gine anka dabi wurin.
On June 21, 1804, Damfodio moved his forces to this place where the famous Tapkinkwato battle was fought and decisively won against the Yunfa army on 28th of June, 1804. Alhaj Usman Abdul Wahab Sarkin Yakin Binji still holds the golden sword of Rumfa, which was seized by this very tree during the glorious Battle of Tapkinkwato. The chief army commander Aliu Jedo was given this sword, which is still under the custody of his descendants. The victory at Tapkinkwato kindled the fire of the jihad by boosting the morale of Damfodio's army. Consequently, Damfodio presented flags at this spot in Gudu, which were a symbol of his declaration of authority. This is an original of such flags on display at the Wazir Junaid History and Culture Bureau in Sokoto. Given out the flags was the issuance of Damfodio's declaration of the holy war, known as the 1804 Jihad. Appointments were made, such as that of the chief army commander given to Aliu Jedo, and Serkin Yara title went to Hussein Bomo. The momentum therefore gathered probably led the jihadists to attempt capturing the Gobir kingdom capital of Alkalawa. They were sadly defeated by the forces of Yunfa at Tsunsua before they reached Alkalawa. The jihadists, had to then move south into Zamfara and Kebbi, where they were warmly received for bringing freedom from the oppression of Gobir. The people were more accommodating, and he was getting more people coming to join him, people like Namoda, Sambadan Ashafa, and the rest. However, this is Endoto within Zamfara, where the Malams refused to accept Damfodio and his reform. Mohammed Bello led a military campaign against them, and the settlement looks like this today. Around 1808, Mohammed Bello again led yet another assault against Gobir and finally conquered it. Sarkin Gobir Yumfa was killed, and so also his brave commanders. The fall of Alkalawa, the capital of Gobir Kingdom, is a significant landmark in the establishment of the Sokoto Caliphate. This is where Yumfa's palace was sited before the defeat.
The jihad started in 1804, concluded in 1808 after the conquest of Alkalawa, and the Sokoto city was established in 1809, a year after the downfall of Alkalawa. So immediately when everything was over, the jihad was over. It was now time for him to enjoy the sufferings he had suffered from his age 20, up to the time when now everything was in his hand. What Shehu did was to resign from public affairs, to resign from political issues, to resign from any engagement, and dedicate himself, retire himself to what? To learning and scholarship, writing and propagating. That's why after the establishment of Sokoto, he moved to Sifawa. So once it happened, he was in Sifawa, he remained in Sifawa, and wrote to Muhammad Bello, his son, requesting for a piece of land which he would be buried after his death. He did not own anything. He did not own a house. He did not own a farm. And see the vast caliphate with over 30 Siri emirates, greater than the present day Nigeria, because the emirate of the Sokoto Caliphate extended up to Burkina Faso, and its foreign relation extended up to Timbuktu and Masina in Mali Republic. So now you can see how huge the empire was, how huge the caliphate was, and how he himself resigned completely from any political engagement. So from him, if you read, you see a person who was more interested in seeing people free from superstition and hero worship.
Damfodio lived in Gwandu in present-day Kebbi State, and this was his house, his mosque, and school. This is the tomb of Damfodio's brother, Abdullahi bin Fodio, at Gwandu. As for Muhammad Bello, Damfodio's son, his tomb and three other sultans are here at Wurno. Damfodio moved from Gwandu to Sifawa, where he became more engaged in writing and teaching. It was here that he wrote Sitra Aji and Tabban Hakika, his famous Fulfilled Poems. His writings were justifying the jihad, giving directives to his followers in the matter of government and religious obligations. While here, he also divided the empire into two, the western part with Gwandu as headquarters and his brother Abdullahi Damfodio in charge, and the eastern part with headquarters in Sokoto and his son Muhammad Bello in charge. This was part of his house at Sifawa, his school, his mosque, and the tomb of his sister Maimunatu. At Magabchi, some few kilometers from Sifawa, Damfodio lived there for about 2 months, and it was under this baobab tree that he wrote to Hausa rulers, inviting them to join the jihad. By 1815, Damfodio left Sifawa for Sokoto. Barely 2 years later, Damfodio died at the age of 63 on 20th of April 1817, having had 37 children, 20 sons and 17 daughters. This is the Hubbara of Sheikh Usman Damfodio. Indeed, it is a historical monument of repute in Biladul Sudan, with graves of many of his family members, lieutenants and associates. Without any doubt, Damfodio created the growth of an ideological and social monument that culminated in the establishment of the Sokoto Caliphate. He was indeed known to have awakened the Hausaland to its responsibilities to provide alternative political, moral, and intellectual leadership. Developing knowledge of oneself is a work in progress, and so this documentary film is a sense of identity for the Sokoto Caliphate.
I believe, honestly, that people, not only in Nigeria but all over the world, need to learn a lot from these great people we have been talking about. They believed in something, and they were quite convinced that what they believed in was right and good and proper. They would want to put it in practice because they believe it would be good not only for them but also for the people they led. So they gave their full commitment to it. We never saw them using their position in order to enrich themselves, in order to take advantage of other people, the weak in society. If today all our leaders all over the country and all over the world would work and give full commitment to whatever it is that they promise their people they would do, if they would practice whatever system of government or leadership they claim to believe in, if they do so, definitely the whole world would be happy.